genetic material, an HIV genetic material.
Yeah, I saw that in the news. Yeah.
Yeah, and you know what? The guy was put in jail. He went to trial. The U.S. District Court, I believe it was in Fargo or maybe Grand Forks. I don't remember that, but the person was given a fine, a small fine, and the sentence was the 17 days in jail he had already served. So that's what somebody gets for trying to bring virulent strains of Ebola, of all things, into the United States. You know, you try to travel with some shampoo on a plane, you're probably going to get a year in jail.
Well, we got Dr. Pianca. We got Dr. Pianca running around. Dr. Eric Pianca running around the countryside, saying he can't wait for airborne Ebola to kill 90% of us. Wayne Madsen, let's finish up with this and then get into the white supremacists in the U.S. government. That story you were telling about behind the scenes has now come out in mainstream news. The good old folks at New Silver Solution. And the website is super. NaturalSilver.com. SupernaturalSilver.com. This is something that kills bacteria, viruses, you name it. Well documented. They've got it down to a super small nano-sized particle. SupernaturalSilver.com. Check them out at Infowars.com. Okay, let's go right back to Wayne Madsen. Wayne, anything else on this flu situation?
I would just say that watch for this thing now the mutations to be reported. We've got some initial reports from Brazil. The German scientists have looked at it. They're claiming it's undergoing mutation, rapid mutation. I would note that the day I talked about this virus mutating, I was on Russia Today. That was on at 12 noon Moscow time. The same day, Margaret Chan, a director of the World Health Organization, was in Moscow, and there was a news conference, and she was pointedly asked, is this virus mutating? And she denied that it was. So we're not getting the straight scoop from the World Health Organization, even though they've declared this a level 6 pandemic. And certainly the Centers for Disease Control, which were for weeks saying that, you know, they were undercounting the number of infections in this country. Now we find out that over a million people are infected here. So there's a real problem with getting good information from these so-called public health, international and national public health organizations.
Well, Wayne, that was the question I wanted to ask you. 3 or 4 days into the panic, a city official I know, I'll just leave it at that, came to the office and brought the internal memorandum from a CDC meeting with state and city officials in San Antonio, where they didn't shut down some schools just north of San Antonio. And it said, we're telling the public we're at level 4. We're already at level 5. In 92 hours, or is it 96? Point is, this is 90 plus hours. We're really going to level 6, but no one's going to be told. And I went on air and posted, the document. And people didn't believe me, and then later it came out, oh, we're at level 6, we've been under it a while. So it's almost like they're drilling for when there really is a level 6 someday. It's like they're saying it's a level 6 in name only for worldwide pandemic, but, I mean, I have that document, and the document says there have been many more deaths and many more illnesses, and I kept getting that chatter from other state and federal people I know. So is this like a fire drill, or is this the real deal?
Well, we don't know how this thing's going to mutate. As a matter of fact, the news today is in the mainstream media anyway that this may mutate into a more virulent strain. So we may not have seen the worst yet. The worst may be coming, but certainly we haven't seen. The health minister of India criticized this country for not screening people leaving the United States because we are the point of infection for many of these countries now that are experiencing their first cases, whether it's one individual. In the case in Nepal, was a family of three traveled from New York back there. Same reports from many, many different countries around the world that the first cases are from the United States, but there seems to be no interest by our public health officials here to try to stop the spread of this overseas. We've got over a million cases, but we're seeing a huge spike today reported in England. Australia is a very bad situation, Australia. And the worst case scenario is those countries that have no public health infrastructure. And now we have the first cases now being reported in sub-Saharan Africa, India, and the Bangladesh. Can
everywhere.
You imagine how many people live there and how easily that will be spread in a country like that?
Why secretly have a level 6 months ago and then announce it a few weeks ago? What's your angle on that? Or any of the intel people any of the press people you talk to? I mean, what are they saying?
Well, you would think that this would be very transparent. You know, a public health issue, why sit on information? That would be like sitting on weather reports. But the way they're dealing with this, we might as well be dealing with meetings at the Federal Reserve. A lot of this stuff is just being held very close. You would think you would want to inform the public about a pandemic, but we see information being withheld on a daily basis, and it makes no sense. And I have to think that there's some criminal predicate to all this, and it would be nice to see them investigate it. But I'm not holding my breath, because it would have been nice to see the FBI really investigate the anthrax attacks on the media and Congress, and they blame this poor Dr. Ivins, who was actually trying to find the perpetrator. They said, you know, it was him after, of course, he committed.
And now it's coming out that his DNA at the mailbox doesn't match, and that he's basically innocent, and nobody wants to talk about how he died in the government mental institution. They just say he took his own life, locked up in the mental institution when they secretly grabbed him. Wayne, I know you're a busy guy, I have to go in a meeting. Do 5 more minutes on the racist angle, if you can, on the other side of this quick break. Can you do that?
Sure.
Okay, great. WayneMadsonReport.com. That's WayneMadsonReport.com, linked up on InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.tv. We'll also come out of the break and put it up on screen for PrisonPlanet.tv members. Stay with us. This is GCN. And go back to Wayne Madsen. But Wayne, before we get into the white supremacists riddling the government, according to some of the reports some of your colleagues have been putting out in your own research, you've written some articles on it. Now coming out mainstream news as usual, you're kind of over the horizon sight. Liberty, freedom, waking up to the corporate structure, it is really exploding exponentially. Do you agree with that?
Oh, certainly. And I think, you know, the fact is more people are now going to the Internet for their news, and they're getting off those George Orwell telescreens, the 3 24/7 cable news networks, which is they're nothing more than propaganda. And, now here in Washington, we have under construction a place called the Institute, the U.S. Institute for Peace, which is really the U.S. Institute for War. That's right out of Orwell. This is going to be the big neocon citadel here in Washington, and they're going to be talking about all kinds of, U.S. intervention in other countries. Latest one, of course, is Honduras, where it looks like our fingerprints are all over that coup.
Well, I wanted to ask you about that, because it's coming out, the generals, as you know, people may not, but once you talk about it, because you were in intelligence, that they are, were trained at School of America's, he was going to legalize drugs, he was actually fighting the cartels, CIA didn't let that happen, that's their main business. But getting into the racist, we saw Von Braun. He attacks in 81 or 82 with fake dynamite and a gun. They disarm him easily. He's held for 6 years. He's then released. He's got all these weird Southern Poverty Law Center connections. You know, they got caught running the white supremacist compound in Elohim City with McVeigh, according to FBI documents declassified. And suddenly Von Braun, right when they're trying to pass all these hate crimes laws, and it got it passed to the House. It happened right as that vote was happening. Now going to the Senate, Von Braun pops up, and it turns out when we were at the National Press Club interviewing you and others that some of the reporters you introduced us to, and now it's been national news, were saying Von Braun was tied into special forces, colonels, commanders, connections of white supremacists, the good old boy roundup from 92 on 60 Minutes with the BATF and FBI selling N-word hunting licenses. Break that down.
Well, the number one person on this is a fellow by the name of John Edward Hurley, and we actually had a forum at the press club on Friday about Justice Department malfeasance and some political prosecutions, notably against Governor Siegelman of Alabama and a few other high-ranking Democrats in the southern states. But one of the things, Hurley was a longtime colleague of the White House press correspondent, Sarah McClendon, who actually was more senior than Helen Thomas. She died a few years ago, but John Hurley was onto this back during Iran-Contra, where he noted that a lot of the people involved with these white supremacist Klan, neo-Nazi organizations...
That's like G. Gordon Liddy with Nixon thought that he was a, a, like a German general, but go ahead.
Right. Well, he found out that many of these people were involved in Iran-Contra. They were in the Reagan administration. They were in the Bush 1 administration. More recently, they were in the George W. Bush administration. A lot of these individuals were also paid informants of the FBI, and we know that one person whose name was mentioned as a guy who worked with Von Braun, this guy Todd Blodgett, he came right out and said he was a paid informant. But these people all were in the Bush 1 administration. A lot of them were in the Bush 1 administration. And I remember my days at Ole Miss where my history professors, Southern history professors, were telling me back during the days of the Klan that there were so many FBI infiltrators. One FBI agent who had infiltrated the Klan would be reporting on other Klan members who turned out to also be FBI agents.
In fact, there were some meetings where there'd be five people and four of them would be FBI.